can hear you. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, one and all. I'm going to present about a child who is 3 years old, a boy, first born of third degree consanguineous marriage.
Darini, can I interrupt you in between, or do you want us to wait till the end of your presentation? Because I think then and there, if we correct you,
yes,
I don't know. You have to go back to each slide otherwise.
Yes,
okay. It's okay with Dr. Lokesh. Dr. Lokesh? Okay, Darini, you go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. 3-year-old boy, first born of third degree consanguineous marriage, residing at Cuddalore, informant being mother with good reliability, was brought with complaints of developmental delay and poor weight gain when compared to the peer group since 6 months of age, now with fever and cough with cold for past 3 days. Since the complaints are suggestive of developmental delay, I would like to start the history from the antenatal period.
Darini, that is fine. But normally, you know, you have to give us a small history of presenting illness. See, what you're going to do is going back to the antenatal period, which is a past history, isn't it? So just briefly tell us what you mean by developmental delay in this child. I mean, how delayed this child is. I just want to imagine a child. That's why I want to imagine how this patient is.
Madam, Lokesh here only.
Okay, he didn't respond, sir. So
he's here only.
He had muted his mic. Okay. Lokesh, I thought we will interrupt her at each slide level so that then and there we clear the doubts. Yeah, I just wanted to get your answer.
Sure. Okay.
So Darini, just give me three lines about how delayed this child is. And because there is a problem about fever, cough and cold, which you will have to also address in the presenting complaints.
Yes,
then go back to your antenatal history. Okay.
So this is a 3-year-old child, ma'am, who is brought with complaints that the mother is not, mother noticed that the child is able to only stand with support and is not much attend, not much playful with the surrounding people, and is doing having a very mild fine motor activities.
Okay.
Like holding the grass knoll is not perfect.
Okay. And fever and cough and cold, the child is admitted for that, or is it a mild one?
It's because of the cough and cold, there was not much of fast breathing, but because of the recurrent episodes of cough and cold, which the mother was complaining, and the poor weight gain, we wanted to evaluate the child for failure to thrive also, ma'am. So we admitted this child.
Okay. Now go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. So I would like to start from the antenatal history. Mother is a 23-year-old primary. She is third degree consanguineous marriage. Marriage sits 1 year. Before marriage, she had PCOD and was under medical management.
So medical management means, did she have treatment for to conceive, or was it just...
No, ma'am. This was prior marriage, ma'am.
Prior to marriage. You have to mention. Okay, fine.
First trimester, she conceived spontaneously.
Okay.
Pregnancy was confirmed at 6 weeks of amenorrhea by urine pregnancy test. Dating scan confirmed at 8 weeks and was corresponding to the gestational age. She was booked and immunized at Cuddalore GH. Folic acid and calcium supplements were started from 8 weeks of gestation. There was no history of fever with rash, excessive vomiting, drug or radiation exposure.
Does excessive vomiting have any, I mean, is it a relevant history in this child? Can you think of any connection between this child?
If there is an anencephalic child, that would cause an excessive vomiting.
Anything else, since you know the condition of the child, you know the problems this child is having, excessive vomiting. I'll give you a clue, the seizures in the child. There are some mothers who are put on pyridoxine for long periods before the hyperemesis. So the child can become pyridoxine dependent. Okay. So that history may be relevant in the neonatal, when there is a neonatal seizure. Okay. Because you might be trying all the AEDs and just pyridoxine will stop the convulsion. So that is important history.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Second trimester, quickening was felt at 20 weeks of gestation. Oral iron and calcium supplements were taken. Anomaly scan was done at 22 weeks of gestation and was reported to be normal. No history was suggestive of pregnancy-induced hypertension or gestational diabetes, bleeding or leaking PV. Third trimester, growth scan was normal. At around 34 weeks of gestation, mother perceived reduced fetal movements and hence consulted and was reassured by the doctors. History of bleeding was spotting PV, abdominal pain or fever. At 37 plus 5 weeks of gestation, mother had labor pain and was admitted at Kallur GH. The total weight gain during pregnancy was approximately 8 kg.
Are you happy with the weight gain?
Ma'am, she was thin built, so I would expect the weight gain of approximately 10 to 12 kg.
Okay, so 8 kg is okay. Okay. So for the perceived reduced fetal movements, nothing was done, you're saying?
Yes, ma'am. Mother was kept in observation for a period of time of around 6 hours and was discharged, ma'am.
Okay. Can you tell me a couple of conditions where you can have a physiological reduction in the fetal movement?
If there is a polyhydramnios, we can have reduced fetal perception.
Mm.
And if the baby is having limited sleeping, if it is more than 12 hours of
First thing you have to say is a sleeping baby. Okay. That's where your kick chart and all comes in. Okay. And the 90 minutes, a baby does not sleep for more than 90 minutes at a stretch. Okay. So if a mother says that beyond that also there is reduced fetal movements, then we have to think of something pathological. Okay. So there are one or two conditions only where we have reduced fetal movements. One is, as I told you, sleep. And another thing they have found that those mothers who have had antenatal steroids, they have found that their fetuses do not move much, it seems, and for 2 days. And there is a reduced even heart rate. So we don't know the reason for that, but there is an observation. Just this is just added information for you. It might not help you in the exam, but just for you to know. Okay, then go ahead.
Thanks, ma'am. Natal history. A mother was brought to Kadlu GH with complaints of pain abdomen. On examination, she had ruptured membrane approximately 4 hours before delivery. On examination, she was fully dilated and there was no progression of labor. So she was delivered by forceps-assisted vaginal delivery. The hind lica was meconium stained. At birth, baby did not cry and required resuscitation measures, which was not, the details are not known. And within 2 hours of life, the baby was shifted to the private hospital under nasal Bronx. Birth weight of the baby is 2.4 kg.
Okay.
Postnatal history. The child was shifted to a private NICU center at Kadlur. Baby was continued on oxygen support via nasal Bronx. At 6 hours of life, child developed seizures and was started on IV anti-epileptics and antibiotics with IV fluids and supportive measures. At 3 days of life, the child was taken off oxygen support. In view of poor sucking effort, baby was started on tube feeds. On day 7 of life, baby was started on oral feeds via Palade. Trial of direct breastfeeding was done, but baby was not able to have a good suck. So started on oral feeds via Palade and gradually increased to full feed on day 10. At 2 weeks of life, child was discharged on Palade feeds and oral anti-epileptic. No history of neonatal jaundice. Since then, the child was on regular follow-up until 2 months of age and then lost follow-up.
Okay, now you can tell me from this particular slide itself, what were all the risk factors for poor neurodevelopmental outcome?
There's a history of birth asphyxia, ma'am, requiring resuscitation. The birth asphyxia is considered to be severe because the baby develops seizures within 6 hours of life.
Yes.
Because of the poor sucking effect and the need for the Palade feed and tube feed, it again means the damage is severe.
Okay.
And this.
Yeah. So now one or two things I would like to tell you. See, the sucking reflex is a survival reflex. Okay. So this baby has to suck in order for him. It's a boy or a girl, you said?
Boy, ma'am.
Boy. Okay. Mm-hmm. So for this baby to survive, the child has to suck on the mother's breast. Okay, so it is a survival reflex. So this is the first reflex which will return after an insult to the brain. So if the survival reflex of sucking does not return, that is a bad prognostic factor. So this child has not, and if the return of the suck takes more than 7 days, then you can be assured that this child is going to, not assured, but you can be convinced that this child is going to have a poor neurodevelopmental outcome. So this is a very major risk factor that this child has. So if you're going to see the mild, moderate and severe risk factors, the poor suck at 7th day of life is one of the risk factors, okay? So this child is having early onset seizures and poor sucking effort, and these are the two, and on AEDs at the time of discharge, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. Now go ahead.
Yeah, just another point, ma'am. The terminology, like birth asphyxia or perinatal asphyxia, because there was no acute event, the child had a mild delayed cry, didn't require aggressive resuscitation, isn't it?
Yes, sir. There's no much
of aggressive. Details, she says, and Apgar was known, both are not known, isn't it?
No. Both of them are, Apgar and the details are not known.
Anyway, we get indirect evidence by there only being oxygen required by nasal prongs. That means the baby would not have been medicine. That's what Lokesh is trying to say.
Okay. Yeah. So it could be intrauterine just before delivery. So the terminology perinatal probably would be more appropriate. Yes. And definitely it indicates a suitable birth dysfunction whenever there is an issue. And two types of injury you can think of at this point of time, because both cortical involvement is there and suitable birth dysfunction is there. Either it can be a acute severe asphyxia where you have deep gray nuclei involvement, which can cause this. And also you can have diffuse cystic encephalomalacia kind of injury, which can give rise to encephalopathy plus suitable birth dysfunction. These are the two types of injuries which we might be looking at, that the examination will be able to clarify.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
History. At 2 months of age, the mother discontinued her follow-up. At 6 months of age, mother noticed developmental delay, like baby is able to only recognize mother and not attain any, not attain head, neck control. And then seek advice. Neck control was attained at 8 months now, and then started sitting with support at 2 years, and now is able to sit without support. At 4 months of age, she started cooing. 6 months, laughs loud. 1.5 years, monosyllabic words, and 2.5 years, speaks bisyllabic words. At 4 months, had a social smile. 6 months, recognizes mother. 1 year, recognizes danger. And 2.5 years, waves bye-bye. At 5 months, hand bidextrous grasp, 6 months unidextrous, and 2 years hand pincer grasp. At 3 years of age, she is now able to sit without support, which is approximate to 8 months, with a developmental quotient of 20%. Holds object by pincer grasp, 12 months, DQ 33%. Tries to scribble, developmental age 9 months, with DQ 25%. Talk bisyllabic words, age 9 months, with DQ 25%. So the overall developmental quotient is 27%, which accounts for severe developmental delay.
Okay, I have to make a comment here. See, first of all, a development quotient cannot be arrived at with a single milestone. Once, okay, it has to be done only by a development pediatrician. What you can assign is only the developmental age of the child. So you can tell this is the developmental age of the child in months as compared to what the child is expected to do, but a DQ should be assigned only by a development pediatrician, because we will look at a lot of parameters before we assign the developmental age, quotient for the child. Okay. Can you tell me one or two equipments or tools by which you can do a development quotient?
Bailey's method and Wesley's method, ma'am.
Wesley?
Yes, Denver, ma'am. Bailey, no. And Denver.
No, Denver is a screening tool. Okay, so development quotient is arrived only by an assessment tool. Okay, so one is DASI, developmental assessment scale for Indian infants. The other one is a Bailey scale for infant development, or Griffith. These are the three assessment tools. Okay, and the second correction I want to make is DQ is never a percentage. A DQ can even be more than 100.
Yes, ma'am.
Have children's DQ going up to 140. Okay, so it is only a number. DQ is only 20, 30, 50, 80. And any DQ above what is normal?
More than 90, ma'am.
More than 85 is normal. Above 85, your DQ is normal. Okay. And so these are the two corrections that you have to make. Don't write in percentage. Don't say development quotient, because it is a what assessment of various what shall I say, milestones, not just with sitting without support. With that one thing, you cannot assign a DQ. So I will say that this child's developmental age is 8 months against a chronological age of 3 years. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Go ahead.
History at 10 months of age, she had multiple episodes of jerky movements of all four limbs with uprolling gaze of about 3 to 4 episodes per day, each episode lasting for less than 3 minutes, with postictal drowsiness for about 1 to 2 hours, and hence was hospitalized. She was evaluated and was started on dual anti-epileptic therapy with phenobarbital and valproate, and is under control now with the dual anti-epileptics. At 1 year 7 months of age, she had complaints of cough with fast breathing and fever, which was suggestive of pneumonia, and was requiring hospitalization for 5 days with the IV antibiotic. No oxygen support was required at this period. History of on and off constipation is present and is on oral laxatives. Now, at present, she is brought with complaints of fever with cough and cold for 3 days, which was high grade intermittent, getting partially relieved on oral medication. There is no associated history of fast breathing or difficulty breathing or added sounds.
So this child has had repeated episodes of respiratory infection, you're saying, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Any reason you think?
The cause micro of aspirations, ma'am.
Micro aspirations. Anything else?
LRTA, poor respiratory clearance. LRTA,
yeah, due to?
Poor respiratory efforts and increased cooling.
Okay, they have chest deformities also, isn't it? We have a highly, you might have a highly compliant chest wall. You might have certain parts of the, say, some lung segments may be permanently compressed because the child is always in a recumbent position. Okay, so that also we have to take. Okay, next.
Negative histories. There is no history of associated complaints of fast breathing, difficulty breathing, abnormal chest movements, altered bowel bladder habit, abnormal distension.
The past history or the present history you're telling now?
For the present fever complaint, ma'am.
Okay. Okay.
Decreased output, vomiting, abnormal jerky movements or altered sensorium. The child, there is no history of irritability, altered consciousness, lethargy, incessant cry or neck stiffness. No visual abnormality, facial asymmetry, drooling of saliva, difficulty in swallowing, inability to close eyelids, speech disturbance, hearing abnormality, pooling of secretion or nasal regurgitation, or no involuntary movements.
You're done with the history?
Yes, ma'am.
So what is the major history that you have not mentioned at all about?
Sensory involvement, ma'am.
No. Sensory, I think even when as clinicians, it's a little difficult to pick up in a cerebral palsy child. You've never mentioned anything about spasticity or floppiness. Shouldn't that come in the history? See, your history, your negative history does not say anything about the tone. You've stopped with cranial nerves. You've told about general negative history, like other systemic history you have told. You've told about higher functions in the form of irritability, altered consciousness and all that. You've come to fascia, you've come to cranial nerves, up to nasal regurgitation. But thereafter, there is no negative history. But you should also say whether this child is a spastic child or a floppy child, whether the mother has difficulty in changing the diapers. Isn't it? Don't you have to mention that? I still cannot visualize how this child actually is. But from your history, that should have come out. Okay?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. So the mother was able to notice increased stiffness of the limbs. There's a
very, very positive history. Okay, it should not come under negative history.
Yes, ma'am.
So that should have come earlier. You were telling about such an elaborate developmental history, no?
Yes, ma'am.
That there it should have come. Okay, go ahead.
Immunization history. As per National Immunization Program, immunized up till 9 months of age. The last vaccine was MMR and MMR. After that, she missed her immunization doses.
She's taking the vaccine in the government hospital or
government hospital, ma'am.
Are they giving MMR or MR in the government hospital?
No.
It's MR. Okay. And I'm very surprised how this child is. What is the weight of the child now?
Weight of the child is
today. Whenever you examine, what was the weight?
Yes, ma'am. Anthropometry.
No, I just want to know the weight of the child.
Weight is 9.5 kg, ma'am.
See, the protein requirement, you're saying that it is much higher than what the child needed.
Ma'am, this high gap, protein calorie gap, which means the child will be malnourished.
Yeah, but see this protein, you're expected to give only 28 grams, but your child is getting 30 grams.
Yes, they were thickening, double thickening the, I mean, not double, they were increasing the scoop level. The formula, she is predominantly formula fed, ma'am, with around 1.5 scoops in 30 ml. 1.5 to 2 scoops in 30 ml.
But shouldn't that reflect on the weight, Dharani? If you think that mother is overfeeding or giving a highly proteinaceous diet, there's something wrong with that, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so something wrong with the protein calculation. Just with milk, I doubt if you can get this high protein.
Yes, ma'am.
You should always, when you're writing it, always check again. Huh?
Yes, ma'am.
Unless a child is well, doing well. Next.
Family history and socioeconomic status. Married since 1 year, third degree consanguineous marriage. No comorbidities in the family. Father is 32 years old, graduate, works in a private concern. Mother is 23 years old, graduate and housewife. Lives in a paka house with a single bedroom and kitchen. Separate toilet facilities are available. Water sources from corporation. And according to modified Kupusami classification, they belong to upper middle class.
Okay, now tell me how the family and socioeconomic history is going to affect this child or influence this child's life.
They are from an upper middle class family, ma'am. So the education status of the parents are also graduate. So discussing about the diagnosis and the multidisciplinary.
Have you told us whether the child is getting physiotherapy or anything? You never told us whether the child is improving with physiotherapy. None of those things came up in the history. I was waiting for that. Because if they're educated, they should have noticed that the child is having problems, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. They have started, ma'am. They have started around 1 year of life.
Yeah, but that should have come in the history. And any developmentally delayed child, if it is a consanguineous marriage, that should show in a pedigree chart of 4 generations should be there. Okay, because we cannot assume, can we straight away, just because it's a HIE history, can we say it is this cerebral palsy only? It can be a mimic, isn't it? So we'll have to find out whether there are other anybody else in the family is affected. It has to be reflected in a pedigree chart. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, next.
Ma'am, summary. Three-year-old boy, actually it's a boy child. 3-year-old boy child, first born out of third
gender
degree.
Identity.
Sorry.
What's the child's name?
Child was Lokesh, ma'am.
Lokesh, okay. You can't make mistakes like this, Dharani.
Yeah, and also married for 1 year, you said.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
You conceived immediately, probably.
Yes, ma'am.
Married
for 1 year before conception, she meant. Because child.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
3-year-old boy child, first born out of third degree consanguineous marriage with significant perinatal history of meconium strain lyca and birth asphyxia with neonatal seizure, presenting with developmental delay and seizure disorder. The suspicion is of hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy sequel. With superimposing LRTI and probably due to microaspirations.
See, at this point, we should be able to think of, so what are the structures involved to start off? and what are the pathologies and what are the etiologies.
Yes,
okay, and the seizure disorder is not a diagnosis in this time, isn't it?
Because you know the etiology.
It is a epilepsy, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
It is a epilepsy, and the newer classification of epilepsy, whether it's a generalized epilepsy or it's a focal with impaired awareness, focal without impaired awareness epilepsy, then you look at the etiology of the epilepsy, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I don't think all of us should stop using this very vague word, which is non-existent in any of the ICD schedules as seizure disorder. We should try and use more specific terminologies, which you can code it. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So, and also as Madam already pointed out, it was very important for us to know the tone.
Yes, sir.
What tonal abnormalities, whether it's in lower limb, whether the parents felt more in the lower limb or upper limb, so that we can say whether it is a spastic diplegia, spastic all four limb involvement. You said there are no abnormal movements, so less likely to be a dyskinetic form of involvement. So all that information is extremely useful, and you should put in there is a pseudobulbar dysfunction.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Very still important.
Yeah. So you need to, at the level of history, you should get so much of information that the examination is going to confirm your history.
Absolutely.
So it doesn't do anything else, examination. So that is has to be coming in a systematic manner, which is we need to get to that level of history taking and summarizing the history. You did a good history, but summarizing, I think we should get more mature. So the structures involved. Okay, now you do this exercise. What are the structures involved?
So child is having increased tone.
Mm-hmm.
There's no dyskinetic, no abnormal movements, increased tone, more of the lower limb than that of the upper limb. Mm-hmm. And there is no action. From the history, there is no cranial nerve involvement, sir.
But there is evidence of recurrent aspirations, which you suspect. What kind of feed the child was being given? Did we discuss that?
So the child is predominantly on milk-based diet, sir, formula-based diet.
Okay, semi-solid or liquid?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, which means that he is still not able to handle the solid food, which is the marker of pseudobulbar dysfunction.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, although not direct lower cranial nerve, it's a part of your cranial nerve dysfunction. The pseudobulbar dysfunction is there. Subrat. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, vision was normal?
Yes, sir. Vision was normal. Hearing was normal, sir.
Special sensory is normal. Okay. So you have pseudobulbar dysfunction plus a spasticity likely lower limb more than upper limb.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So diffuse cortical white matter, a subcortical white matter with epilepsy is there?
Yes, sir.
So you have, it is a generalized epilepsy, focal epilepsy.
Generalized.
No multifocal seizures.
No, sir.
Okay, so diffuse subcortical plus also there is evidence of cortical involvement. Along with that, you have cognitive impairment as well.
Yes, sir.
So two markers to say there is a gray matter involvement, cortical speech delay plus cognitive delay and seizures. And you have spasticity with pseudobulbar dysfunction, which is saying diffuse white matter involvement.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it? So that is what you should let us know at the end of history. Based on the history, these are the structures involved. Then we go to the pathologies. So it's a static pathology or a progressive pathology?
Static pathology.
Static pathology. Okay. So looking like a single point insult, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what are the, given the history, what are the different etiologies you are going to look at with this history?
So this is looking multifactorial. From antenatal period, there's a history of nutritional, there's a malnutrition deficit in the mother with an weight gain of only 8, and there's a history of decreased fetal movement in the antenatal period. In the perinatal period, there's a history of prolonged labor with meconium aspiration, meconium stain liquor, and perinatal insult. requiring resuscitation.
So in the sense, you are putting etiology as a perinatal asphyxia only.
It could be it is multifactorial also, so because of the
why do you want to confuse? There is a strong history, isn't it?
Yeah,
there is a strong history of perinatal asphyxia. Everything is just adding on to that. Her nutrition is going to produce a placental infusion, that's all. Everything is going to lead on to the same thing only. Okay,
yeah,
don't say multifactorial etiology and confuse the issue.
So, in other words, do you want to consider any other etiologic differentials other than perinatal asphyxia?
No, sir. Perinatal asphyxia, sir.
Is there is there any condition which can mimic a cerebral palsy? Are there conditions like that?
Yes, ma'am. Leukodystrophies.
Leukodystrophies is not a static pathology, isn't it? That's why we asked you to commit to a nature of pathology. You committed to a static pathology. So while you are think and answer, so what are the mimics which can actually have this kind of very slow improvement and behave like a perinatal asphyxia, especially because there is a third degree consanguinity which increases the risk of autosomal recessive disorders, as madam had pointed out.
You can't get a bigger clue than this.
Metabolic.
Yeah, okay. What metabolic disorders?
Glutaric aciduria.
It's acute decompensation, isn't it? Usually between 6 months to 10 months, they have acute decompensation with slightly large head.
Yeah.
And a dystonic presentation.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so the conditions which you need to think of, especially with that consanguinity, would be whether any of the recessive inherited pathologies like your neurotransmitter disorders can have this kind of outcome.
DOPA response. Yes, sir.
Tyrosine hydroxylase, autosomal recessive DOPA responsive dystonia.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so those things can do this. And similarly, some of the congenital muscular dystrophies where they can have both motor and cognitive difficulties with seizures, they can do this kind of slow improvement can be there initially before the any regression. Congenital myopathies are predominantly motor. Okay, and other conditions which can mimic radiologically but not necessarily clinically are multiple sulfatase deficiency, molybdenum cofactor deficiencies.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And sometimes you can have cervical cord injuries in breech presentations, which can present as spastic quadriplegia, but cognitively they are fine, they will not have epilepsy. Okay. Yes, so all these things, you should have a list of. So unless you come with the differentials, your brain will start not start thinking about laterally.
Yeah.
You should always have differentials for localization. Once you are clear the pathology and etiology, you should have list of few things and say I'm more very likely first and second, third or etiologies are HIE, but these are the other things which might be remotely possible. You might be in for a surprise later on. So if you block out every other etiology at the time of history, then it will become difficult. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, carry on.
On examination, anthropometry, her height, height is 88 centimeters on the third centile. Weight is 9.2.
Don't you have to start with a general examination? Do you straight away go and measure the child? You don't have a general examination at all in your presentation. Don't you have to see whether the child is conscious, alert, comfortable?
Yes, ma'am. Child
don't go to this. You go back to your first slide and just tell us from, you've seen the child, you tell us, then you go ahead.
Child is alert, is responding to the surroundings, recognizes mother and strangers.
Child, is there anemia? Is there cyanosis? Is there edema? Those are the things which you have to say. Even if it's a neurological case, you're looking at it holistically, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. Advice Child is alert and playful, recognizes mother and strangers, is comfortable with the examination. Child is having no pallor, child is pale, no cyanosis, no clubbing, no lymphadenopathy, edema. On vital examination, her heart rate was 110 per minute with a regular rhythm, normal volume, no specific character, no radio.
Heart rate for a 3-year-old?
Pulse rate. Yes, ma'am.
It's okay, no harm. Tell. Go ahead. Tell.
No radio radial delay, no radio femoral delay, and all peripheral pulses are well felt. Respiratory rate, child's respiratory rate is 28 breaths per minute, abdominal thoracic type. VP was 96-58 mm of mercury in right arm in supine position. Temperature was normal. Anthropometric measures, his height was 88 centimeter on the third centile. Weight is 9.5 kgs, which is less than the third centile.
Were you able to stretch this child and to see the length, height of the child?
There was spasticity, ma'am, but not to the rate of contractures and all, ma'am. The child is like...
No, what prevented you from looking at the length? Isn't that a better parameter for this child?
Yes, ma'am.
That no child, if it's a spastic child, it's difficult for you to get the exact length, isn't it? Actually, there are parameters in which you measure the crown rump and then you multiply it by a normal level and all that. That's how you measure the height in a spastic child. Okay, not by the regular way of measuring the height. Okay. And what is the purpose of chest circumference and abdominal circumference in this child? Do we have standards?
No.
Then why? Has no business to be here. Okay, don't measure chest, abdomen. You see, you're not going to have enough time. This 45 minutes itself, your history itself was not very complete. Okay, next.
Head to toe examination. Child is microcephalic. Hair is normal with a flat occiput. There's a squint in the right eye. Esotropia. With the oral cavity, there is a dental caries and swollen gums. Bilateral cortical thumb is present, no contracture, no bed sores, no dysmorphic facies or no neurocutaneous markers. Ears, neck, chest, abdomen, spine and genitals are normal.
Yeah, and then when you're also thinking of IEM, you're also supposed to say no abnormal odors also in these kind of children, okay? And when you mean hair is normal, what did you mean by that? What are the things that can show you that there is an underlying neuro developmental disorder in the hair?
Biotinase deficiency or phenyl ketonuria, there could be alopecia, ma'am.
Alopecia or
hypopigmentation of the.
Okay, that can be there. Then you can have two worlds. Normally, we all have one world in our head, from which the hair starts, okay, to go round. So when you have more than one, when you have two whorls of hair, that is one indication that there is a neurodevelopmental disorder. And the occiput also, see whether it is flat or whether there is a plagiocephaly. Flat occiput means this child is spending more time in the recumbent position. Okay, so that is one thing. And there is something, you'll have redundant neck folds in these children who have microcephaly. At the base of the neck, you will have extra folds of skin because the scalp is growing at a normal pace, but the skull is not growing at a normal pace. So you can have redundant folds at the base of the neck. Okay, so those are some of the things that you have to look for in these children.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Is there any overriding of sutures or anything like that?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
I think that's a very important point to differentiate. Although here it is very clear it is a primary brain injury, but in a child comes with microcephaly without other clues, we need to first see whether there is a, feel the sutures, see whether there is a stepping or there is a ridging.
Yes.
So if there is a ridging, that you are looking at primary craniosynostosis. If there is a step, then it's a primary brain injury because the bone is growing as per the expected this one, because the brain is not growing, there is a overlapping which is happening. So that information should be given out in a child with microcephaly very clear.
Yes. And sometimes these children tend to have a lot of hair on the head, you know, all the hair is concentrated in that little head. So you can tend to miss the sutural, you know, the abnormality. So please run your hand over the scalp and find out. Don't miss the findings. Yeah,
definitely.
Next.
Higher motor function. Child is alert and smiling, making eye contact with mother, recognizes strangers and is responding in bisyllable words. With right-handedness and there's no involuntary movements. Posture in supine position with the upper arm adducted at the shoulder, flexed at the elbow, and the lower limb adducted at the hip and extended at the knee joint with plantar flexion at ankle joint. There's no obvious wasting or contracture or involuntary movements.
Which is the first joint which will develop contractures?
Okay.
So this child didn't have any of those, and both the limbs, you said, are only used a singular, you said only upper limb, but both the limbs are involved, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Equally. Okay. Both upper limbs and both lower limbs.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Next.
Yes, ma'am. Cranial nerve examination. Cranial nerve 1 could not be assessed. Cranial nerve 2, gross vision looks normal. He is able to follow and reaches for bright object. Fundus light reflex is present. 3, 4, and 6, able to move follow objects in all quadrants.
What else do you look for in the fundus, Dharani, in this kind of children?
Ma'am, if it is associated with IEM, then we have to look for cherry red spots, any optic atrophy, retinitis pigmentosa.
Chorioretinitis?
Chorioretinitis.
No, the cherry red spot would be an inappropriate answer here because you are looking at a static encephalopathy. Most of the children with cherry red spot will have a degenerative presentation. So as madam said, chorioretinitis, evidence of optic atrophy and the squint, what you have already mentioned. Yeah. So mainly fundus examination for optic atrophy and chorioretinitis.
Yes.
Okay.
3, 4, and 6, able to follow objects in all quadrants. There's a right eye non-paralytic esotropia present. 5th, muscle of mastication was felt and sensation was intact over the face. Cranial nerve 7, able to close eyes completely. Bilateral nasal folds are present. There's no angle of deviation. There's no deviation of angle of mouth. No drooling of saliva. And taste sensation could not be tested. Cranial nerve 8, he is able to turn head and localize to sound and gesture. 9 and 10, uvula is in midline. There was actually no pooling of saliva, but gag reflex was present. Cranial nerve 11, turns face on resistance. 12, the tongue is in midline and there's no fibrillations.
Supposing this child was a newborn.
Yes, ma'am.
How do you look for 3, 4, and 6? Here, you probably dangled a toy and made the child follow objects in all quadrants.
Dolls.
Okay. When does it disappear? Or does
after
it
disappear? 2 months.
Oh, fine. So once child starts fixing on objects, it disappears. Does it come back at any time or is it permanently lost?
I mean, the brainstem involvement of comatose.
Okay, very good. Okay, fine. Okay, so now this child you said is having a non-paralytic squint.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, but child is able to follow.
Yes, ma'am. He's following objects, ma'am.
Okay. Is that enough for you to say that his vision is normal in a 3-year-old?
No, ma'am.
What else can we do?
Yeah.
we can show three fingers and see whether this child is doing the same thing. Okay. Mm-hmm. And what about his hearing? You're going to tell us how he how you taught that his hearing is normal. Is there any way you're going to tell us later?
Ma'am, when we asked, when we made sounds from behind, he was able to turn and get the objects.
Three-year-old? Have you heard of Murphy's Law of Hearing? So all that is in the infancy, okay? So by the time this child is three-year-old, we'll have to ask certain questions. You said that this child is saying only bisyllables.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this bisyllables are, at what age will they say bisyllables?
1.5, ma'am.
Bisyllables.
9 months.
9 months,
sorry, sir.
9 months, yeah. So by the time the child is 1.5, we should be much older. So see what kind of questions if the child is able to hear and answer. 7 to 9 months, they will listen to the voice. They will listen to his name being told. Okay. So those are the things specifically we'll have to ask. There is no point in just telling he's turning to sound. That is a very gross way of assessing hearing. Okay, that's what I was trying to say. Okay, go ahead. So first, second now you said is the pupils you have not told us.
The reflexes, ma'am. Huh? Reflexes and...
Why not hear? What if the examiner is not going to allow you to go till the end of the presentation? Here you have to tell. Second nerve is that only, isn't it? Your pupils.
Yes, ma'am. Light reflex and accommodation reflex is normal, ma'am.
Okay, next.
Motor examination in supine position with upper limbs flexed at the elbow, adducted at shoulder, and lower limbs adducted at hip and extended at knee joint with plantar flexion at ankle joint. Bulk, it is bilaterally symmetrical in all four limbs. Midarm circumference is 12.5 centimeters on both upper limb. Mid forearm is 10 centimeters. Mid thigh is 22.5 centimeters and mid calf is 18 centimeters. Tone, on inspection, it had an oblique contour. Palpation, there was resistance to passive movements is increased and range of passive movements is decreased. More on the lower limbs than that of the upper limbs. And there's no abnormal movements seen.
See, the entire discussion is based on that one word, hypertonia, isn't it? Your diagnosis. And you have just finished it off like, what can I say? With one word. How should you justify that hypertonia?
The resistance is increased and range is decreased.
What are the types of hypertonia you know?
Spasticity and rigidity, ma'am.
Yeah, where you have not mentioned in anywhere that you don't like the word spastic, is it? It's neither come in your history nor in your clinical findings. Isn't it? Don't you have to mention?
Yes, ma'am.
Because your whole localization changes, isn't it? The structures involved changes.
Yeah, where the patient is, you have to decide, isn't it, ma?
Yes, sir.
Is there any way of classifying this spasticity? Can you just grade it, rather?
Sorry, ma'am?
Can you grade your hypertonia?
Ma'am, I don't understand.
How severe is the hypertonia? Can you grade it, I'm asking? Is there any way of grading it? Is there any need to grade it?
Yes, ma'am. It was
food. Who is going to benefit more from grading? It's usually as clinicians, we don't grade. We can say, of course, there is a severe hypertonia when it is in a flex, very rigid. I mean, you're not able to bend in any angle. Then you say it is a severe hypertonia. So between 0 and 4, you have grade for hypertonia. But mostly it is used by the physiotherapists. They will tell you at the end of repeated therapy whether the tone is coming down from 4 to 3, 3 to 2, like that. And also it is to reassure the mother that her child is doing better and to continue the therapy. So for all that, we need to know. It's called Ashworth grading system. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. And also for neurology as well, ma'am, when we are considering utilization of botulinum toxin, grade 2 and 3, do benefit from this botulinum toxin, whereas four is almost contracture, so it is not going to benefit. So you are going to choose the children who have grade 2 and 3 for the injections and choose the muscles. And all spasticity should be mentioned across the joints.
Exactly.
It won't be so uniform. Here you have told lower limb more than upper limb. I want to know whether it is more at the ankle joint, more at the hamstrings, more at the adductors. Is there a gradation within the lower limb joints? Also, in the upper limb, where is it? Whether it is a pronator spasticity, which is usually the common thing, or it's a elbow flexor spasticity, which is they keep in the flexed position. So, or the wrist flexor spasticity, sometimes they almost give a fruit drop, wrist drop kind of appearance because of the spasticity. The pectorals can also be spastic. So, for all of, it's not just for you, for all of them, the trainees who are there, it has to be exercise done every time that you are going to measure and discuss the spasticity or any tonal changes across joints and differentiate between right and left. So whether it's a symmetric involvement of the parenchyma, asymmetric involvement of parenchyma. See, you are trying to look at what is happening in the brain by your clinical history and the examination. You have done the history. Now in examination, you are trying to tell us now, is it spasticity or is it rigidity?
Spasticity, sir.
Spasticity. So you are telling still the white matter, which we consider as a likely site of pathology in the history, which is confirmed. Now you are telling it is lower limb more than upper limb. Similarly, for intervention, it becomes very important. We have to tell us whether there are contractures, no contractures, full range of joint movement is possible or not, and the gradation across each joint should be mentioned. Okay.
Yes, sir. Power best examined during examination. In shoulder,
it is 3x5, so there's no variation according to you.
Yes, ma'am. He was able to lift against the gravity, and in upper limb, it was much more easier for him than compared to the lower limb, ma'am.
Okay, but
this sorry.
Go ahead.
Now, this is something I've always fascinated. I always train our trainees that a child who is not cooperative, this mode of cannot be done.
So you
have to use qualitative terms. The child is able to move against gravity. Is able to hold object in the grip is good. So, and moves against up to the shoulder joint movement is until this range. Those kind of words can be used, but you cannot use, the child will not be able to do it against resistance, isn't it?
Yes,
the child,
sir.
Your developmental age is maybe 6 months, 7 months? You don't expect them to cooperate for your exam, motor system examination using the scale, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So I'm not sure the examiners are going to be insisting on using this scale. They would be happy to know that what is the qualitative movements across each joints on both the sides.
Yes, sir.
That is what practically you are doing. This looks very artificial, isn't it?
Yes.
We tried giving chocolates, he was trying to grab it, sir. He was able to grab it. And when we were taking it back from him, he was, we were easily able to take it back. He was not having a very great grasp to hold.
Okay,
it.
Sure. Okay. Both the sides.
Yes, sir, both the sides. Yeah. And for the lower limbs, we tried, asked him to kick our legs. He was able to lift it, but not able to kick it very strong. And flexing and extension were done, but he was not like, it was not more than three, sir.
Yeah.
But you said he's having a bilateral twisting of the hands, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
But you're saying that he's not holding on to anything also, huh?
Yes, ma'am. Like the... when we gave the wrapper side, when we tried giving him the chocolate, he was not getting the grasp of the chocolate. No.
He's holding on to anything. You mean the grasp is not there?
Yes, ma'am.
This child is able to sit or not?
Yes, ma'am. After past one and a half months, he's able to sit, it seems, ma'am.
You are showing the videos?
No, sir.
I think it's very important.
Unable to stand. That's what you said.
Ma'am?
Is able to sit but unable to stand.
Yes, ma'am.
I think we would request, because these things are important, to check the techniques as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, videos have to be there to cross confirm.
At least useful things. You should have had.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Anything else you have in your presentation?
No, ma'am. I didn't take videos.
Okay.
Reflexes, superficial reflexes, conjunctival, corneal, and abdominal reflexes preserved. Plantar.
Why did you test corneal reflex?
He had.
How did you test? Tell me.
When we took the whisk for cotton only, he was able to close his eyes.
So that was conjunctival or corneal?
That's conjunctival, sir.
Corneal, you have written normal.
Lower end of the cornea, sir.
No, with the child moving, not cooperative, how easy or difficult is to do that?
Difficult.
So what I want you people to understand is, we are not expecting you to just write down the list of things. Do what is relevant. Corneal reflex, I wouldn't be bothered unless you are thinking of some sensory neuropathy in the child. There is corneal ulcer or something. Then yes, essential to look at this one. But otherwise, conjunctival reflex will give enough information.
Yes.
So why do you have to, just for completion, noting it down and getting stuck like this? Okay, so write down only what you have done. It's easy for the examiner to know you have not done something.
Yes, sir.
Okay, depending on the age and this one. Okay, carry on.
And your primitive reflexes, what did you mean by absent except bilateral cortical thumb?
The persistence of ADNR, Moros, that all was not there, ma'am.
Is there a difference between primitive reflexes and developmental reflexes, Dr. Lokesh? I thought that both are different.
I think we use only primitive reflexes, and which they are lost as they go along. What all the reflexes you have checked for in this child?
We checked for Moros, sir, ATNR, asymmetric tonic.
Those are all neonatal reflexes which have no business to be here, isn't it? But about your palmomental, jaw jerk and all that? Those
are
ones which I would have put them under primitive. That's why I'm asking.
Jaja can be part of your pyramidal reflex as well. If you have a significant pseudobulbar, you can have an exaggerated jaja.
You should have specifically mentioned, isn't it, here?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Mm. Okay, see, your clinical examination, you should take some more time, Dharani, because CP is a definite case for you, and it is a complete case because they can ask you about anything based on this case. They can go into nutrition, they can go into immunization, they can go into even the respiratory system examination. Okay, so you need to practice and see, you write a template so that you don't miss out on all those things. Okay, so which neonatal reflex will persist? Do all of them disappear?
A parachute
reflex. Writing reflex.
Okay.
Writing reflex, parachute, and Landau's reflex.
Okay. Okay. So now your all the reflexes, other deep reflexes, you're saying they're all were all exaggerated.
Yes, ma'am.
Is clonus normal at any time, or is it always abnormal? Clonus, presence of clonus.
If it is one, then then it is not.
Huh?
Always abnormal, ma'am.
It's always abnormal in the newborn period?
Newborn, it's normal. Rest of the period, it's abnormal, ma'am. Like, after... Newborn,
how many beats are normal?
Sorry, ma'am?
How many beats are normal? Clonus.
Yes.
Somebody's there to help you. 6 beats, okay? Up to 6 are normal in a newborn, okay? That's just for added information. Okay, go to the next.
Sensation, crude touch and pain response was present. Cerebral signs and coordination could not be tested. Gait could not be assessed. no involuntary movements are present. Other system examination, cardiovascular, respiratory, and abdomen was normal, ma'am. Respiratory system, there was no added sounds or creps at this point of admission. There is no conducted sounds also.
How many teeth did this child have, Darani?
The baby had dental caries, but dental formula, ma'am, I didn't notice. I noticed that baby had swollen gums with dental caries. I didn't.
Why do they have dental caries?
Poor hygiene, ma'am.
Why? Ma'am?
Why? Poor.
Why do they have poor dental hygiene? No, you're finished with your presentation, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, before we ask you the questions, you tell us a diagnosis, then we'll ask you the questions. We have, I think, about 20 minutes more to tell us.
Spine? Did you tell anything about the spine?
Spine was normal, sir.
But you haven't mentioned that.
It is in the head-to-toe examination have been.
Okay, mentioned. Okay, sure. Okay. Normal in the sense, sort of the paraspinal muscle weakness is one of the characteristic feature when children are not able to pull to sit by themselves or they are not able to bear weight. So how do you know if there is a paraspinal weakness on clinical examination?
How was he sitting?
Ma'am, sorry?
Was he sitting on his own?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
What was the posture of the spine? Was it curved, bent forward? No.
Sitting with back straight, back bent to one side.
Back towards me. He was leaning forward.
Leaning forward. And so that is a sign of paraspinal weakness. And if you were you able to see the spine of the child prominently?
Yes, sir.
So that is an indication of paraspinal weakness as well. Because if you feel yourself, the spine will be buried between the two paraspinal muscles. So... Yes, whereas in a weak child where the spine is, paraspinal muscles are weak, you can see the spine, the paraspinal muscles will not be well developed. So that's why they are not able to pull to sit. And that is also the very reason we don't use medications like baclofen to treat these children, because already this is very hypotonic and weak. If you give muscle relaxant, which will relax whole body, it will make the trunk further weak. Although the limb are spastic, but the trunk is generally hypotonic and weak. So that's why you should use only medications which act focally. Okay.
And for the stone examination, no, I think it is worth it when it's a small child to examine the tone in three, that is active and passive tone. Okay. So active tone will be this traction response. In that also, you can see the position of the neck. When you're pulling the child up by his wrists, you see the position of the neck. See whether the neck is lagging behind or falling forward. If the head is lagging behind, it is a sign of an extensor tone in the neck. You look at the back, whether it is straight or curved. Okay. You see the position of the elbows. If the elbows are very close to the body, it means he's hypertonic. If it is very much extended, it is hypotonic. It should just be adequately bent. Okay. So that is for your traction response. Then you can hold the baby by the arm, by the armpits, that is your axillary suspension, and look at the tone again. Mm-hmm. And then your ventral suspension. So examining each group of muscles may be a little difficult in a small child, but this will give us a lot of information. Traction response, your vertical suspension, and your axillary suspension. So that is for your active tone. For your passive tone, you have the angles, especially for children who are less than a year. You can, of course, look at your adductor angle, popliteal angle, heel to ear, and all that you can look for. Okay. So those are the ways in which you do an overall assessment of the tone, because it might not be possible for you to do it in each group of muscle and to write it down. So for that, this overall assessment will work.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you tell us your, again and again, you've written girl, Darini, which is a very wrong thing to do. Okay.
3 years old boy born out of third degree consanguineous marriage with history of perinatal hypoxia and neonatal seizure with static encephalopathy, with spastic diplegia, microcephaly, with no visual or hearing deficit, with severe developmental delay, with failure to thrive and no obvious contractual involuntary movements, with possible etiology being hypoxic ischemic encephalopathic sequel.
So why do you say spastic diplegia?
Ma'am, while assessing the power, it was more of the lower limbs were more involved than that of the upper limbs.
You said power is 3/5 in all the joints possible.
Ma'am, during the assessment of the power, the upper limbs were much powerful than that of the lower. The strength was good in the upper limb than that of the lower limb.
Why I'm thinking whether diplegia is possible? You said there is a pseudo bulbar palsy.
Yes.
So which is pseudo bulbar palsy more common, with diplegia or quadriplegia?
Quadriplegia.
And you said we localized the lesion to being in the cortex, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Diplegia, where exactly will be the problem?
The ventricular region.
But why do you get it in now? Okay, since you've written that, what causes the spastic diplegia? What kind of babies get diplegia?
Preterm babies, ma'am.
Why?
Low birth, periventricular leukomalacia.
Why?
The bridging vessels will be fragile and that.
What is that area which is there in a preterm which is not there in a term baby? There's something called a germinal matrix.
Yes, ma'am.
Germinal matrix will involute when the baby becomes a term baby. Okay. So that's why that is a highly vascular area, and where you can have any small trauma or anything can cause permanent damage there. Okay. So that's why you get a spastic, that area subserving the lower limbs. Okay. That is besides the point. So Lokesh, tell her.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. It can't be a diplegia.
Yeah, definitely. I think all these points are in favor of more of a spastic all four limb involvement with pseudobulbar dysfunction. Okay. And with the epilepsy, which is well controlled or difficult to control?
Well controlled, sir.
Well controlled epilepsy, probably generalized onset. And etiology with what are the comorbidities? Failure to thrive.
And recurrent LRTA.
Recurrent LRTA.
The child was a low birth weight baby, isn't it?
2.4, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
2.4.
You couldn't bring that out in the history diagnosis and all that. Low birth weight is it a risk factor or not?
Yes, ma'am. Risk factor.
And you also said that mother is undernourished, she's not gained much weight. So there is an intrauterine insult itself already, isn't it? So a chronic hypoxia on which the acute hypoxia of prolonged labor, together have resulted probably in the intrapartum asphyxia as well. Okay. So if we are done with this case, we'll just discuss something about cerebral palsy.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So once again, just to complete, do we need to rearrange the structures involved, or you have confirmed the structures involved?
It's confirming if it's quadriplegia with pseudobulbar palsy.
Yeah, so there is a diffuse white matter injury. Historically, there is epilepsy and developmental delay. So it is involving both diffuse cortical and diffuse white matter involvement with pseudobulbar. So the structures involved are confirmed. What you thought on history, you are confirmed on the examination. And it is a static encephalopathy. You have comorbidities in these things with the micro aspirations and failure to thrive as part of the comorbidities. And what else we have? So etiologically, any other differentials?
You can add your dental caries also.
Yes, absolutely. Dental caries.
Yeah.
So it is very important to list out the comorbidities. List out whether the other thing which I didn't hear is whether there was constipation, there are sleep issues.
No.
Because what matters to the parents day to day is whether the child does not pass motions, is having feeding difficulties, is having everyday seizures, he's having sleep issues. Those things bother the parents. So you need to list out them. And if they are there, you need to put it into comorbidities so that you can address, you can medically and therapy wise, you can address those problems systematically.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and etiologically, I think because we don't have any other information for other differential diagnosis, I think your perinatal asphyxia is still a possibility. And maybe in the MRI, you might expect either a diffuse cystic encephalomalacia, but usually vision will be poor in diffuse cystic encephalomalacia. So otherwise, parasagittal injuries are the other things where you can have lower limb involvement more than upper limb with pseudobulbar. Okay, so that is what you are anticipating on the MRI.
Sir.
Okay, fine, go ahead.
Okay. So what would you like to do for this child now?
Ma'am, as of now, child has presented with fever with cough, so a CBC and a chest X-ray would help us find the risk for any microaspiration or LRTI.
What causes dental caries, Dharani?
Clogging of food, ma'am.
Yeah, so this child has a spastic tongue, isn't it? Maybe not so early, but that will come subsequently when the child is not able to remove the food by moving the tongue. So the food can accumulate in the sides of the cheek. Second is the child, just because this child has feeding difficulties, they're usually given a lot of sweetened drinks. You yourself said that this child is given very concentrated milk. So the child can go to sleep with a bottle in the mouth. That can cause. Then you have this child having a very hyper-reactive, or shall I say, when you put a brush into the mouth, the child's jaws will clamp onto the brush. Okay, the child will not allow you to brush the teeth. So it becomes a very major issue, even brushing the teeth for this child. So in these children, we normally tell the mother to use a finger brush, which is available in the baby shop, with which she can just brush the teeth instead of actually using a toothbrush. Okay, so dental caries is rampant in these children because of that. And feeding difficulties, we said one is most of the time it is a pseudobulbar palsy, and the child is unable to chew the food, again because of the spastic tongue, make it into a bolus and push it to the back of the throat. So invariably they're fed liquid diet only. Okay, so this can result in malnutrition. It can result in constipation also. A child is not fed on high fiber diet, and the child cannot squat in the toilet. So that can result in constipation. Yeah, so these are the things that we have to bring out in the history and also bring it out in the management. So how we are going to enable this child to have a smooth bowel movements. Of course, other than laxatives, we are going to make the child's use some kind of aids by which it can sit in the toilet. Okay, so constipation, I don't know whether you mentioned, but sleep is very, very important. History of sleep, okay, that is a higher function. If a child is able to sleep well, it's a good thing. These children cannot have a good sleep due to dash, dash, dash. Why can't a child with cerebral palsy sleep well? What are the reasons? Main reason. Pain. There's a lot of pain in these children. Okay. They have very stiff spastic muscles, which causes a lot of pain. The child will not even be able to roll from one position to the other. Okay. So that pain, then the child can have, of course, seizures interrupting the sleep. The child can have a gastroesophageal reflux because of, again, a hyperactive esophagus. So these are the things which will interfere with the sleep of the child. Okay. So you, in the higher functions, when you're telling, both in the history and in the findings, please mention that the child is having, whether the child is having a disturbed sleep or smooth sleep. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I wanted to know whether, how early you can predict whether a child can have cerebral palsy or whether the child is going in for cerebral palsy or not. Is it important to diagnose early, or whenever we diagnose, the treatment and outcome is the same?
Ma'am, early itself, you can, I mean, the early markers of CT is like lack of alertness, lethargy, lack of alertness or consciousness, increase in tone of the muscle.
Is that, can I say that 100% these things mean cerebral palsy only?
No.
Not a neurological disorder, but we cannot say that it is CP itself as such. Yeah, but in the newborn period itself, can I predict cerebral palsy?
If it is a stage three, according to the...
Okay, those are risk factors. Those are risk factors, isn't it? Stage three of what?
Sarnet and Sarnet classification.
So those are all predictors. If the child is having an APGAR of less than three, an extended APGAR score, if the child is in stage three of Sarnath and Sarnath, if the child is having MRI problems, those are all predictors. It can predict. But there are two clinical tools by which I can predict if the child is going in for cerebral palsy or not. Okay. One is general movement assessment, GMA. Okay. Are you there?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
GMA has picked up a lot of, very, very important tool now. The newborn period you can pick up. General movement assessment. Not everybody can do it though. They have to undergo training. What we can do is to take a video of the child's movement and send it to the experts who have undergone training. And that they can predict it has a sensitivity of about 98%. In the newborn period, a general movement assessment. Okay. So depending on the gestational age, these are the movements which a newborn can have. And if it is anything other than that, we can predict. And second, all of us can do is the Hammersmith infant neurological examination. All of us can do it. Okay. So that is a neurological examination. We are doing it in our hospital in the newborn period and subsequently throughout infancy. And a score of less than, depending on the age of the child. Okay, so supposing this child is about 3 months of age, the score of less than 57. A score of less than 57 at 3 months, 57, 60, 63, 65 at 3, 6, 9, 12 months will predict cerebral palsy. Why I'm telling you this is the earlier you pick up, the earlier you can start therapy and make use of the neuroplasticity of the brain and improve the outcome. We may not be able to prevent, but we can definitely improve the outcome. Okay, so do these two things you have to remember, GMA and HINE. Of course, MRI also. Okay, these are the three things which can predict whether a child can go in for cerebral palsy or not. So if a HINE score, that is Hammersmith infant neurological examination score, is less than 40, 100% this child cannot have a normal outcome.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, very, very high chance of that child going in for cerebral palsy. So at 3 months itself, I can tell whether the child is going in for cerebral palsy or not. Okay, yes, ma'am. So these are the two diagnostic tools which will help. Okay, so supposing I tell that definitely this child is not cerebral palsy, is there any criteria to say that this child is not having cerebral palsy?
What?
It can't be cerebral palsy. Why?
If there is increasing head circumference. Progressive lesion or degree, yeah. I mean, regression of the...
That should be first. If it's progression, there is, you know that cerebral palsy, the clinical findings, is only the lesion is static, but the clinical findings may vary, isn't it? Once you do therapy, it can improve. If you don't do anything, it can become worse. Those things are there. But if it is a progressive or a regression of milestones, then you think of something other than cerebral palsy. Then next.
If you have a family.
Okay, usually cerebral palsy doesn't run in families. Okay, and anything?
Sibling death.
Okay, the third one is when there are no perinatal events at all. Think of something else.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, when there are no perinatal events at all, very smooth, normal antenatal period and intrapartum and immediate neonatal. Nothing in the perinatal history, then you always have to think of IEM as a possibility or any of the other neuroregressive disorders. Okay? Now, how do you classify cerebral palsy?
based on topographic, functional, and anatomical, based upon spastic, or hypotonic, mixed, or dyskinetic.
I know you say hypotonic. Hypotonic is not a classification.
Sorry, spastic, atonic, dyskinetic, and mixed.
Dyskinetic and mixed.
Yeah.
Where's topesh?
Yeah.
So we don't use the word hypotonic cerebral palsy, isn't it? Because these are all pre-runners of spastic. They can be hypotonic for some time and then become spastic.
Yeah, mostly the dyskinetic ones, especially when the carnicals are the deep gray nuclear involvement ones, can have we can be hypotonic initially, and then they become spastic or dyskinetic later on.
Yes.
So what is the definition, by the way, for cerebral palsy?
It's a static encephalopathy, non-progressive lesion of the tone and movement disorder. Caused,
what is non-progressive? Madam already gave lesion. You a clue. Incentral. The lesion is not more progressive.
But the,
so the definition movement. Is it's a dynamic disorder of tone and motor abilities, secondary to a static single point insult to a developing brain.
Yes.
So it is, the manifestations are not static. Oh. The insult is static. Okay, yes. So you need to be thinking in that terms. So whatever the tone, as we discussed, hypotonia will be evolve into something else. It doesn't mean that there is a new insult happening. It is that in the developing brain, those changes are happening secondary to a this one. The tonal abnormalities are dynamic.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so so just to finish up, what are all the therapies that this child needs, this girl or boy? What and all are you going to do?
Ma'am, a pediatrician should coordinate, and he should have a visual ENT, neurologist, psychologist.
What visual problems this child will have in cerebral palsy?
Squint and refractory errors.
Mm. More important will be? Most important will be? Important
cortical vision loss, ma'am.
Cortical visual impairment. It is a CVI. Okay, so when you send the child to the ophthalmologist, they will tell you that the eye is normal, retina is normal, but yet the child will not be able to see because the lesion is in the occipital cortex. It is in the cortex. Okay, so the child will not be able to see. Is it reversible?
No, ma'am.
Why?
It is the insult in the.
It is reversible because, as I told you, neuroplasticity of the brain, it can be reversed. If you continuously keep giving visual stimulation, then other areas of the brain which are not affected will take over the function of that part of the brain which is subserving vision. Okay. So that's why we have to do visual stimulation. Visual stimulation, how do we do visual stimulation? Just tell me one or two things. I think the time is up. The coordinator can tell us when to stop. We'll stop. Visual stimulation.
Ma'am, it's 5 more minutes.
Okay. Just, I just want to give them a few tips to do early stimulation at home. For visual stimulation, tell us.
A toy can be given to at the early age itself to concentrate on the bright. A bright object should be given to the baby at an early age so that he looks at it. And
okay, the best way to stimulate vision is by using, when you start off in the newborn period, is by using black and white contrast patterns.
Nice.
Contrast patterns. If you can just use a chessboard. A chessboard can be used, which is available even on the platform, that whenever the child is awake, just keep showing that, show it in front of the child's eyes about 10 times. At a stretch, and then after 2 hours again, and whenever the child is awake, so that will stimulate the vision. Okay, then of course you hang something. You can even hang a ribbon or a feather, something where the child can see. So that is for visual stimulation, and all this will reverse the cortical visual impairment. Okay, yes, provided it is not very severe damage. And in the newborn period, if there is a history of hypoglycemia, please do check vision again and again, because it is the parieto-occipital cortex which gets affected in hypoglycemia, where vision is also affected. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So, history of jaundice is there.
One question.
Yes, sir. Srinivasan, sir.
Will you allow me? Yeah, because time is... So, yes. Usually when such a child is given, we tell from your examination, what are the positive things which are going to help the child and what are the things which are likely to face, you know, post difficulties in rehabilitation of the child. Okay, so for example, you know, persistent seizures, severe microcephaly, and visual disturbances, hearing difficulty. So they must be able to chalk out the positive side of the child where the, you know, physiotherapy and occupational therapy will do a lot of benefit and this thing out. So that is usually one of the exercises examiners give. So as if they, you know, once they have found out, they must be able to chalk out, decide what are the most positive things, because you must always see the positive things in a child, which will be, you know, helpful to tell the parents. These are the things. So kindly, in the counseling, it will be very helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And also, all children with cerebral visual impairment should get a electroencephalogram, that's sleep EEG, because epileptic encephalopathy will also contribute to visual impairment. So if you treat them with iodosteroids, so that if the encephalopathy improves, the vision also tends to improve.
Okay, I think we'll wind up if there is anything. Darini, do you have any doubts or if anybody wants to ask us anything?
Also, make sure all the other treatable causes like a thyroid function testing, those things have been taken care of, because if those correctable factors are not taken care of, it's a problem, because the child also had short stature, maybe looking at the bone age, see other hormonal etiologies are there. So look at the child holistically, not just advising physiotherapy and sending him off. And because there is history of consanguinity, they are planning another child. If things are not clear, you might still want to go ahead and do a neuroimaging to make sure it is just a perinatal etiology, not a recurrent pathology. So it may, in this case, it may not be required, but in individual cases, you need to be extremely alert. In the era where genetics is so advanced, you can pick up lots of diagnosis. You should be extremely careful while counseling these families.
Yes. Thank you. This is where your MRI will help. And it will tell us what the etiology is. It's very, very important, as Lokesh is saying, because if we are going to miss some other diagnosis and just brand every case as a cerebral palsy, then we will end up in problems. So it's very important to establish the diagnosis. Okay. So MRI, whether it should be done or not, I think it should be done in all
definitely cases. Definitely, ma'am. I think we should have a clear diagnosis, especially when they are planning second child. You need to give them very 100% clarity that it's non-recurrent pathology.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, ma'am.
Madam, I will check the chat box and question answers all answered, no?
Yes, sir.
I'm answering one, sir.
Okay.
Few of them are answered, sir.
I saw that few answered. Yes, some of them are there still. Yes, that's why I just want.
Probably they can do the typing in the chat box, sir. So I thank Dr. Darini for making up the good presentation, and I thank Dr. Rama Chandra Mohan as well as Dr. Lokesh for giving wonderful